If you live in Prineville, Terrebonne, Powell Butte, or forest crossing within Oregon, you actually live within a Yellowstone-like volcano, albeit the remnants of one that is today long extinct. Yet, if you had only been in this very spot a mere 29.56 million years ago, you would have witnessed a spectacular volcanic landscape which had been recently incinerated for at least 15 miles in every direction, with some areas annihilated up to 106 miles distant. What had recently occurred, despite not being a true super eruption, may have looked like the aftermath of one, with thousands of fumaroles from the still cooling pyroclastic flows actively degassing. In fact, you would have been inside a massive 1150 foot deep depression in the ground with a prominent rim that extended across 24.6 miles of lifeless landscape, marking the collapsed area inside a supermassive caldera. Yet, there were also well-known volcanic colors dotting the landscape, with yellow and orange silver mineral patches around fumaroles, the turquoise color of acidic hot springs along with the white carbonate rocks associated with geysers, and the bright red of still-forming mercury deposits. While this landscape today looks nothing like its ancient counterpart, there are still reminders spread across the landscape which implicate this ancient cataclysm. This ranges from stunning rock spires in Smith Rock State Park, which largely showcases several hundred feet thick of ash and placed in a single eruption, to the rhyolite of Barnes Butte and its associated mercury mineralization, to a series of locations that mark the edge of its now eroded caldera rim. This is the story of the Crooked River Caldera, the first major eruption to ever occur from the infamous Yellowstone Hotspot, which is today centered underneath northwest Wyoming. Approximately 32 million years ago, a large plume of unusually warm mantle, which was around 300 degrees Celsius, or about 23% hotter than the surrounding mantle rock, continued to rise due to its lower density. After migrating through a gap which existed in the subducting Farallon tectonic plate, large amounts of molten rock intrude into the lowermost crust, causing it to become increasingly dense. Eventually, this reached a threshold causing a large chunk of the lowermost crust to detach and sink into the mantle. This at the same time caused tremendous volumes of molten rock to intrude upwards into the middle and then upper crust, where it pooled for some time, experiencing fractional crystallization and eventually taking on a mushy and crystal-rich mass with the composition of rhyolite. This building phase continued for thousands, perhaps even tens of thousands or hundreds of thousands of years, causing hundreds of cubic kilometers of magma to accumulate. Then, when the latest batch of rising molten rock from a deeper magma reservoir reached the shallow magma chamber, a threshold was passed which caused large volumes of material rich in gas to rapidly rise to the surface. Steam rising from one spot in the ground soon became multiple spots, which occurred alongside thousands of earthquakes, some of which may have reached magnitude 6. Then, a powerful explosion occurred, pulverizing the rock above it in a several thousand foot radius into finely grained ash, along with fragmenting lava, carrying it in an eruption plume rapidly up to an altitude of 50 kilometers or 164,000 feet. As large boulders of tephra began raining down across an ever-expanding radius, other vents erupted, and parts of multiple eruption columns were too heavy to rise on rising columns of buoyant hot air. As a result, they collapsed back to the ground, generating pyroclastic flows which swept across the landscape at speeds of 100 to 200 miles per hour, creating hurricane-force wind walls of death up to 1,500 feet high, which carried with it lava and rock fragments up to the size of small homes. Everything was incinerated across what expanded to become a 6,500 square mile region, which is almost three-quarters the size of New Jersey. Since winds were blowing strongly to the northwest at the time of the eruption, the ash accumulated to their thickest in the northwest section of the caldera. Then, due to the large amount of erupted material totaling 580 cubic kilometers of tephra, a large portion of the underlying magma chamber had been drained. This caused a large mass of overlying rock to collapse downwards like a sinkhole by more than 1,000 feet, forming a massive 24.6-mile-long and 13.3-mile-wide caldera. While no additional major eruptions would occur thereafter, since the caldera rim faults that had formed represented paths of least resistance, molten rock intruded into them on multiple occasions, some of which erupted onto the surface and formed viscous, several hundred foot tall rhyolite and dacite lava domes. These lava domes formed in still explosive eruptions that produced volumes of ash and smaller pyroclastic flows, but were multiple orders of magnitude smaller than the prior caldera-forming eruption. At least 30 such lava domes formed over the next 2.12 million years, with the last eruption forming a series of two rhyolite domes north of Orocho Reservoir, which today have cliffs.